We spent 2 years on this program questioning the strained relationship between Mitt Romney's campaign and the press and whether journalists were unfairly painting the Republican candidate as an awkward, out-of-touch plutocrat.
I like being able to fire people.
I'm not concerned about the very poor.
They brought us whole binders full of women.
Was there a tilt toward Obama that continues to this day? I spoke earlier with Stuart Stevens, the veteran Republican media man who was the campaign's top strategist. Stuart Stevens, welcome. Do you believe today that much of the media is in the tank for Barack Obama?
Oh, it's a... That's not a yes or no question. In the tank, I would say no. So yes or no
too
question,
I would say no. Too favorable toward the president, too sympathetic to the president, how would you put it?
I think that after the election, you're going to have a lot tougher questions that are going to be asked because you're out of an election environment. I think you're seeing that this past weekend with this whole golf outing. So I think that they will be more critical now. I think.
But you're saying that the press should finally be more critical of the fact that Barack Obama went golfing with Tiger Woods?
Well, I think that the degree to which there is not a choice between him and a Republican candidate makes it easier for them to be tougher on the president. I think that's natural.
And so that leads me obviously to say that when there was a choice between Barack Obama and a Republican candidate, who you happen to work for, you think that made it more conducive for the media to be easier on the president. Why is that?
I've never been a media basher. I mean, I spend a lot of my life writing. If you look at the people who are covering our race, I've been writing for a long time and written probably a lot more than they have. So I'm very sympathetic to their situation.
But you are also at the same time an astute observer and critiquer of the modern day press. And you have just opened the door for me to ask you whether or not when it is a choice between a Democrat and Republican, you believe, it's implied that you believe that most journalists are more sympathetic to the Democratic candidate.
Well, look, let's start at what we know. There's every reason to believe that the majority of journalists tend to lean Democratic. And we know people are people. That affects it. Now, that's not to say that they can't be good journalists and that they can't be fair. But I think that when you're in these arguments, and a lot of campaigns are about arguments, that there is a
an inherent disposition.
Disposition to believe the fundamental basis of their argument, of a Democratic argument, versus a Republican argument. And I think that that doesn't mean you can't win an argument. I think it means that it makes it more difficult to carry the day in that argument.
When Mitt Romney...
But this is sort of, I think, very old trod territory that we've
been
through.
But it is a chance for me and our viewers to hear from you, who are the chief strategist of the campaign. And let me turn it around. It was a close election for most of that time. When Mitt Romney lost, the next day, the next hour, it seemed, a lot of conservative pundits came out and said Romney was a terrible candidate. Mm-hmm. Now, if obviously it had gone the other way, they would have said you were a genius. Did it bother you to get so much criticism from your own tribe?
I think that in a campaign, you know, the proper way to deal with criticism is to try to listen to it. Because every day in campaigns, you make a lot of mistakes. And if you look at Mitt Romney's approach, after every one of our debates, all he wanted to hear about was what he did wrong and how he could improve. And I think that's a good model for us. So when conservatives and people supporting Republican Party criticized us, we tried to listen and to see what we could learn from it and to go from there.
And yet you also often, to me and other reporters, and sometimes in your writing, would dismiss what you called the green room culture. Mm-hmm. You felt it was an insular, beltway, mm-hmm. press corps mentality that was out of touch with what was happening on the campaign trail.
Yeah.
Why is that?
Because it's true. One of the realities is that Mitt Romney very much was not a D.C.-based candidate. He, by virtue of the fact, you know, he was not a congressman or a senator. He had not been someone who had spent a lot of time coming up to the shows and gone through
right,
that.
Right, so he didn't have those deep relationships.
He didn't have a lot of relationships. Yes. And a lot of this is people being people. He hadn't spent a lot of time getting to know these reporters and how it affected them. And I think that there is a desire for a certain vetting process to happen in the green room that Governor Romney hadn't really submitted himself to. He submitted himself to voters. I think that's one. Two, I think that the economic realities of this moment are very important here. And I think it's more important than any ideological bias here. 7 out of 10 of the most wealthy counties in America now are in the D.C. area. And New York City is New York City. At a time when we're in the greatest near economic depression since the Depression. And I think that the experience that most of the journalists have today in this area is very different than the experience that most Americans have.
I'd be willing to concede that. And you're certainly right that Romney, to many in the press,
was
an outsider. But during the 2 years that he ran for president, he didn't really make much of a serious effort to develop those relationships. He didn't do a lot of interviews, certainly with print reporters. And your campaign, I don't blame you for this because you were usually pretty accessible, but your campaign's press shop was kind of notorious among journalists for being difficult to get reach, to get to comment on things. Did you, looking back, was that a mistake? It's hard to circumvent this giant machine called the mainstream media.
I think we did a lot more interviews than the president did. We were a lot
mostly
more
at the local level.
We did a lot of national press, you know. And we did a lot more interviews than and we were more accessible as our culture than the president.
Listen, was not terribly accessible either. But why, Stuart, was there this belief among many in my profession that there was a strained, difficult relationship between your campaign and the Fourth Estate?
You'd have to ask the reporters to feel that way, not me, because I didn't feel that way with reporters. But let me just say this. In the primary, we were running against candidates who were, in some cases, completely living off the press, in the sense of they would go anywhere and do anything for publicity. The debates were a big part of that. And so to have that level of accessibility versus the level where we were trying to carry a larger message and to talk about big problems is not a really, we had different goals here. And also, campaigns are about message discipline. And I think that there is a natural, I think, positive tug of war between a campaign and the press. And that's
press wants a news story every day. You want to drive a message. And in your case, Romney's message was about the economy, the awful state of the economy.
Actually, there was a time when they wanted a news story every day.
Yeah.
Now they need a news story every 2 hours. And that's a great pressure on these reporters that I'm very sympathetic to. I think that, you know, the idea that there's a filing deadline and, you know, when we came up, they have tremendous amount of pressure on them now. I mean, as you know better than I. And it's to get this, to get that, and it creates, I think, an environment that is very conducive to the creation of news, the invention of news, that there is none, so therefore we will invent it.
In that environment, since you bring this up, do you think that Twitter and the need to have something to say or something provocative to say or something snarky to say every 20 seconds has hurt campaign coverage? You think it hurt the Romney campaign?
Oh, I think we used it to our advantage in a lot of cases. I mean, if you take this Hillary Rosen little flap, I mean,
she criticized
Ann Romney for career choices. We were able to use Twitter to our advantage. Listen, I've been.
And yet you don't tweet yourself, although I know you follow Twitter closely.
I don't tweet. However, I've been a somewhat obsessive follower of Twitter. I've had a Twitter account. You know, since the very beginning
the beginning of time
that the service went up. And I think that it's fascinating. I mean, the way that I would follow debates is just through Twitter. That's all I would look at, is how people were tweeting during the debates.
Is that a good snapshot?
It's the only thing. I think it's a terrific snapshot because it is as close you can get to talking to reporters while a debate is going on, while an event is going on. The thing about Twitter that is both it's great thing and it's very dangerous thing, as we've seen a lot. And it's part of why I chose, and so, as did Matt Rhodes, not to tweet but to leave it to our communication shop, is it's very stream of consciousness. And as we know, once it's out there,
you can't reel it back.
It's out there.